Laudetur Jesus Christus. Welcome back to Vatican Radio's coverage of this ongoing day of retreat for priests during this Jubilee for priests. Pope Francis has just arrived here in the Basilica carrying a bouquet of flowers, as he often does when he comes here, to bring to Our Lady, his mother, with great filial devotion. We see many priests and seminarians who have gathered here for the event, 6,000 of them here in Rome for this Jubilee. And from wherever you're joining us today, we're glad that you can be with us. A special greeting to our viewers on EWTN, Telecare, Salt and Light TV, Radio Maria, and from wherever you happen to be, thank you for tuning in. Pope Francis is going to a chapel which is on the left side of this ancient basilica, one of the only basilicas, of the major basilicas here to keep its original structure. He's going into the chapel dedicated to Our Lady of Salus Popoli Romani, which is an icon depicting Our Lady holding the child Jesus. Before the Pope goes on any voyage outside of Italy, he comes here to bring her flowers before the trip and after the trip, and to invoke her intercession for safe travels. After the singing of the Salve Regina, the Pope will now enter the main basilica. Today's retreat for priests is being organized around what we call the Liturgy of the Hours, hours during the day that are set aside for prayer. This morning we celebrated Terce, which means the third hour since dawn. So that was happens around 9 p.m. in the morning. And now we have Sext, which is Latin for the sixth hour. And the Holy Father will lead them in the praying the Liturgy of the Hours, and they will hear his second reflection for priests gathered here, all of them centering around God's mercy.
Deus in adiutorium meum intende. Gloria Patri et Filio et Spiritui Sancto.
After the introduction, we'll now hear the hymn for this great Jubilee, Misericordia sicut Padre, merciful as the Father is merciful.
Misericordia sicut Padre, misericordia. diamo grazie al Padre perché è buono.
In eterno misericordia eius.
Ha creato il mondo con sapienza.
In eterno misericordia eius.
Conduce il suo popolo nella storia.
In eterno misericordia eius.
Perdona e accoglie i suoi figli.
In eterno misericordia eius. Misericordia sicutate, misericordia sicutate, misericordia sicutate, misericordia sicutate.
Give thanks to the sunlight of the nations.
In eterno misericordia eius.
He loved us with a heart of flesh.
In eterno misericordia eius.
As we receive from him, let us also give to him.
In eterno misericordia eius.
Hearts open to those who hunger and thirst.
In eterno misericordia eius.
We'll now pray together the psalm today, Psalm 22. I lift up my eyes to you who sit enthroned in heaven.
Abitatore onnipotente dei cieli, a te levo i miei occhi, a te che abiti nei cieli. Pietà di noi, Signore, pietà di noi. Già troppo ci hanno colmato di scherni. Noi siamo troppo sazi degli scherni dei gaudenti, del disprezzo dei superbi. Come era nel principio, ora e sempre, nei secoli dei secoli. Amen.
We'll now hear Psalm 123. So it's a moment of brief silence after each psalm to truly meditate on the
Il
content.
Nostro aiuto è nel nome del Signore.
Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Se il Signore non fosse stato con noi, lo dica Israele. Se il Signore non fosse stato con noi, quando uomini ci assalirono.
Psalm
le acque ci avrebbero travolto.
The psalm says, if the Lord had not been on our side, let Israel say, if the Lord had not been on our side when people attacked us, they would have swallowed us alive when their anger flared against us. The flood would have engulfed us, the torrent would have swept over us, the raging waters would have swept us away. Praise be to the Lord who has not let us be torn by their teeth. We have escaped like a bird from the fowler's snare. The snare has been broken, and we have escaped. Our help is in the name of the Lord, the Maker of heaven and earth. We'll hear one more psalm before the brief scripture reading. Psalm 124.
Circonda il tuo popolo, Signore, ora e sempre. Chi confida nel Signore è come il monte Sion. Non vacilla, è stabile per sempre. I monti cingono Gerusalemme, il Signore è intorno al suo popolo, ora e sempre.
The psalm reads, those who trust in the Lord are like Mount Zion, which cannot be shaken, but endures forever. As the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord surrounds his people, both now and forever. The scepter of the wicked will not remain over the land allotted to the righteous, for then the righteous might use their hands to do evil. Lord, do good to those who are good, to those who are upright in heart, but to those who turn to crooked ways, the Lord will banish with the evildoers. Peace be upon Israel. After these three psalms, we'll have a brief reading from the book of Amos, chapter 5, verse 8.
Colui che ha fatto le Pleiadi e Orione cambia il buio.
Seek him that maketh the seven stars and Orion, and turneth the shadow of death into the morning, and makes the day dark without night, and calls for the waters of the sea, and pours them out upon the face of the earth. The Lord is his name. Few moments of silence before the concluding prayer, and then we will hear the second meditation today by Pope Francis.
Magnificentia et pulcritudo in conspectu eius, potentia et decor in sanctuario eius.
Omnipotens eterna Deus, apodque nihil est tenebrosum, nihil.
Omnipotent and eternal God, for you nothing is darkness. Give us the splendor of your light, so that, following your will, we may walk faithfully with our hearts open and generous along your path. We ask this through Christ our Lord. We'll now hear today's second reflection from the Holy Father. All of them have the common thread of mercy.
Dopo aver pregato,
after having prayed,
dignità vergognosa,
and meditated upon,
e vergogna dignitosa, che è proprio la misericordia al posto
or the embarrassment. We talked about mercy.
Andiamo avanti.
But let's go ahead and continue our discussion with this meditation.
sul ricettacolo della misericordia.
On the vessel of mercy.
È semplice.
It's simple.
Io potrei dire una
I could
frase e andarmene.
Say one phrase and leave, because it's one only that needs to be said.
Il ricettacolo della misericordia è il nostro peccato.
The vessel of mercy is our sin. It's so simple.
Ma spesso
but often
il nostro peccato è
our sin
come una
it's like a
buccata dalla quale
sieve or a leaky bucket from which grace quickly drains.
Perché due sono le colpe che ha commesso il mio popolo. Ha abbandonato me, sorgente.
My sin have committed two sins. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living water, and dug out cisterns for themselves, cracked cisterns that can hold no water. We read this in the book of Jeremiah, chapter 2, verse 13.
Da qui la necessità che il Signore esplicita a Pietro di perdonare 70 volte 7.
This is why the Lord had to teach Peter the need to forgive 70 times 7.
Dio non si stanca di perdonare.
God never tires of forgiving us, but we tire of asking for his forgiveness. He never tires of forgiving, even though he sees how hard it is for his grace to take root in the parched and rocky soil of our hearts. When he sees the path is full of weeds and rocks and he's not Pelagian. And so he never tires of forgiving us. He never stops sowing his mercy and forgiveness. And he does again and again, again, 70 times, 7 times.
Cuori ricreati.
Hearts created anew.
Tuttavia, possiamo fare un passo ulteriore in questa misericordia di Dio che è sempre più grande della nostra coscienza.
Let us take a closer look at this mercy of God that is always greater than our consciousness of our sinfulness.
Non si stanca di perdonarci, ma rinnova.
The Lord never tires of forgiving us. But more than that, he renews the wineskins in which we receive that forgiveness. He uses a new wineskin for the new wine of his mercy, not one that is patched or old. And that wineskin is mercy itself. His mercy, which we experience and then show through helping others.
Il cuore che ha ricevuto misericordia,
a heart that has known mercy, is not patched or old, but new, recreated.
Quello di cui dice Davide, crea in me un cuore puro, rinnova in me uno spirito saldo.
It is the heart for which David prayed when he said, a pure heart create for me, O God. Put a steadfast spirit within me. The heart created anew is a good vessel. It is no longer battered and leaky. The liturgy echoes the heartfelt conviction of the church in the beautiful prayer that follows the first reading of the Easter Vigil. O God, who wonderfully created the universe, then more wonderfully recreated it in the redemption.
Questo nella veglia pasquale.
This is during the Easter Vigil.
Pertanto questa seconda creazione,
this second creation, is even more wondrous than the first.
È un cuore che sa di essere ricreato grazie alla fusione della sua miseria con il perdono di Dio.
Our heart is conscious of having been created anew, thanks to the coalescence of its own poverty and God's forgiveness. And so for this reason, it is a heart which has been shown mercy and therefore shows mercy. It feels the effect of the grace poured out upon its wounds and its sinfulness. It feels mercy in assuaging its guilt, watering its aridity with love and rekindling its hope, when, with the same grace, it then forgives the other sinners and treats them with compassion. This mercy takes root in good soil, where water does not drain off, but gives life.
Nell'esercizio di questa misericordia che ripara il male altrui, nessuno è migliore per aiutare a curarlo di colui che mantiene viva l'esperienza di essere stato oggetto di misericordia.
The best practitioners of this mercy that rights wrongs are those who know that they themselves are forgiven and sent to help others. Look at yourselves, remember your own story. Tell yourself your story, your own history, and there you'll find a lot of mercy. We see this with addiction counselors. Those who have overcome their own addiction are usually those who can best understand, help, and challenge others. So too, the best confessors are usually themselves good penitents. We can ask ourselves, how do I go to confession? Almost all the great saints were great sinners, or, like Saint Thérèse, knew that it was by sheer grace that they were not.
Così, il vero recipiente della misericordia.
So, the real vessel of mercy, then, is the mercy which each of us received and which created in us a new heart. So this new wineskin to which Jesus referred in Luke 5:37 is the healed sore that has been healed. Here we enter more deeply into the mystery of the Son, Jesus, who is the Father's mercy made flesh. Here too we can find the definitive icon of the vessel of mercy in the wounds of the risen Lord. Those wounds remind us that the traces of our sins forgiven by God never completely heal or disappear. They remain as scars. The wounds of our Lord, Saint Bernard, in two different sermons that are very beautiful about the Lord's wounds, it is there in the Lord's wounds where we find mercy. He's courageous. He says, you feel lost, you feel abandoned, go inside those wounds. And there you'll find mercy.
In quella sensibilità propria delle cicatrici.
In that sensitivity of the scars that remind us of our old wounds but do not hurt. This is where divine mercy takes its place in our wounds. In the scars of the Lord, which remain, even though he is risen, he took those scars with him, his perfectly intact body, there's no bruises, but he wanted to bring the scars of the crucifixion up with him into heaven, and our scars as well. All of us, it happens that when we go to see the doctor, and we have some scar here or there, and the doctor asks us, what's this scar for? What's that scar? Maybe some operation. And we're talking about the scars of the soul. And the Lord sees them. He sees where he has healed us.
Nella sensibilità di Cristo risorto che conserva le sue piaghe non solo nei piedi e nelle mani, ma nel suo
in the Lord's wounds in his hands and feet, but also in his pierced heart. We find the true meaning of sin and grace there. In the wounded heart.
Contemplando il cuore piagato del Signore,
contemplating that wounded heart of the Lord, we see ourselves reflected in him.
Si assomigliano il nostro cuore e il suo.
His heart and our heart are similar, because both are wounded and risen. But we know that his heart was pure love and was wounded because it willed to be so. Our heart, on the other hand, was pure wound, which was healed because it allowed itself to be loved. Not acceptance. We become receptacles, vessels of mercy. Holy Father, taking a break, a small drink of water. For just joining us, we're in St. Mary Major's Basilica here in Rome. Pope Francis preaching a retreat for priests. This is his second meditation of three today.
I nostri santi hanno ricevuto la misericordia.
Our saints received mercy.
Altri che si sono lasciati ricreare il cuore della misericordia.
We can benefit from contemplating others who let their hearts be recreated by mercy and by seeing the vessel in which they received that mercy. Paul received mercy in the harsh and inflexible vessel of his judgment shaped by the law. His harsh judgment made him a persecutor. Mercy so changed him that he sought those who were far off. From the pagan world, and at the same time showed great understanding and mercy to those who were as he had been. Paul was willing to be an outcast, provided he could save his own people. His approach can be summed up in this way. He did not judge even himself, but instead let himself be justified by a God who is greater than his conscience, appealing to Jesus as the faithful advocate from whose love nothing and no one could separate him. Paul's understanding of God's unconditional mercy was radical. His realization that God's mercy overcomes the inner wound that subjects us to two laws, the law of the flesh and the law of the spirit, was the fruit of a mind open to absolute truth, wounded in the very place where the law and the light become a trap. The famous thorn that the Lord did not take away from him was the vessel in which Paul received God's mercy. Peter reserves mercy in his presumption of being a man of good sense. He was sensible with the sound, practical wisdom of a fisherman who knows from experience when to fish and when not to. But he was also sensible when, in his excitement at walking on water and hauling in miraculous catches of fish, he gets carried away with himself and realizes that he has to ask help from the only one who can save him. Peter was healed of his deepest wound of all, that of denying his friend. He goes and he became Pope as well. Perhaps the reproach of Paul, who confronted him with his duplicity, has to do with this. It may be that Paul felt that he had been worse before knowing Christ, whereas Peter had denied Christ after knowing him. Still, once Peter was healed of that wound, he became a merciful pastor, a solid rock on which one can always build, since it is a weak rock that has been healed. It's not a stumbling stone for the weak. In the gospel, Peter is the disciple whom the Lord corrects the most. He takes him to task more than the others. Jesus is constantly correcting him, even to the end, saying, "What is it to you?
And
what is that to you? Follow me," as we read in John 21, verse 22. Tradition tells us that Jesus appeared once again to Peter as he was fleeing Rome. The image of Peter being crucified, head down, is perhaps the best expression of this vessel of a hard head who, in order to be shown mercy, lowered himself, abased himself even in giving the supreme witness of his love for the Lord. Peter did not want to end his life saying, "I learned the lesson," but rather, "Since my head is never going to get it right, I will put it on the bottom." What he put on top were his feet, the feet that the Lord had washed. For Peter, those feet were the vessel in which he received the mercy of his friend and Lord.
Giovanni sarà guarito nella sua superbia di voler riparare al male col fuoco.
John was healed in his pride for wanting to requite evil with fire. He who was a, quote, son of thunder would end up writing to his little children and seem like a
il figlio del tuono. Agostino
and seem like a kindly grandfather who speaks only of love. St. Augustine was healed in his regret for being a latecomer. And this made him suffer a lot. In that nostalgia, he was healed. As he wrote, "Late have I loved you," he would find a creative and loving way to make up for lost time by writing his confessions.
Francesco riceve sempre di più la misericordia.
Saint Francis experienced mercy at many points in his life.
Il recettacolo definitivo che diventò piaghe reali più che baciare il lebbroso.
Perhaps the definitive vessel which became real wounds was not so much kissing the leper, marrying lady poverty, or feeling himself a brother to every creature, as the experience of having to watch over in merciful silence the order he had founded. This here that I found, where I find the great heroicness of Saint Francis, having to watch over in merciful silence the order he had founded. Francis saw his brethren divided under the very banner of poverty. The devil makes us quarrel among ourselves, not defending the most holy things, but with an evil spirit. Saint Ignatius was healed in his vanity. And if that was the vessel, we can catch a glimpse of how great must have been his yearning for vainglory, which was transformed in his strenuous efforts to seek the greater glory of God. In his diary of a country priest, Bernanos tells of a life of an ordinary priest inspired by the life of the curé of Ars. There are two beautiful passages that describe the reflections of the priest in the final moments of his unexpected illness. He says,
le ultime settimane che Dio mi concederà di continuare a sostenere la responsabilità.
May God grant me the grace in these last weeks to continue to take care of the parish, but I shall give less thought to the future. I shall work in the present.
Sembra affatto su misura per me.
I feel such work as within my power.
Non ho successo che nelle cose piccole.
For I only succeed in small things. And when I am tried by anxiety, I am bound to say that it is in the small things that release me. Here we see a very small vessel of mercy, one that has to do with the minuscule joys of our pastoral life, and where we receive and bestow the infinite mercy of the Father through little gestures. Little gestures of the priest, those small gestures of the priest. Another paragraph says, it is all over now. The strange mistrust I had of myself, of my own being, has flown, I believe, forever. That conflict is done. I cannot understand it anymore. I'm reconciled to myself, to the poor shell that is me. How easy it is to hate oneself. True grace is to forget. Yet if pride could die in us, the supreme grace would be to love oneself in all simplicity, as one would love any of those who themselves have suffered and loved in Christ. This is the vessel, to love oneself in all simplicity, as one would love any of those who themselves have suffered and loved in Christ. It is an ordinary vessel, like an old jar we can borrow even from the poor.
Cura Brochero, un po' della mia patria.
Blessed Brochero, who is from my country, an Argentinian priest, soon to be canonized, let his heart be shaped by God's mercy. In the end, his vessel was his own leprous body. He wanted to die on horseback, crossing a mountain stream on the way to anoint a sick person. Among the last things he said was, there is no ultimate glory in this life.
This
makes us think, there is no ultimate glory in this life. He says, I'm quite happy with what God has done with me regarding my sight, and I thank him for that. He had been made blind. While I could serve other people, he kept my senses whole and strong. Today, when I can no longer do so, he has taken away one of my physical senses. In this world, there is no ultimate glory, and we have our more than enough misery. Often, our work remains unfinished, so being at peace with that is always a grace. We are allowed to, quote, let things go so that the Lord can bless and perfect them. We shouldn't be overly concerned. In this way, we can be open to the pain and joy of our brothers and sisters. It was Cardinal Vantuan who used to say that in prison, the Lord taught him to distinguish between God's business, to which he devoted his whole life, and his free life as a priest and bishop, and God himself, to whom he was devoted during his imprisonment. We could go on and on about other saints in this way, how they were vessels of God's mercy. But let's turn now to Our Lady. We're in her house. Mary as vessel of source and source of mercy. Ascending the stairway of the saints in our pursuit of vessels of mercy, we come at last to Our Lady. She is the simple yet perfect vessel that both receives and bestows mercy. Her free yes to grace is the very opposite of the sin that led to the downfall of the prodigal son. Her mercy is very much her own, very much our own, and very much that of the Church. A mercy which is very much her own, very much our own, and very much that of the Church. As she says in the Magnificat, she knows that God has looked with favor upon her humility, and she recognizes that God's mercy is from generation to generation. Mary can see the working of this mercy, and she feels embraced together with all of Israel by it. She treasures in her heart the memory and promise of God's infinite mercy for his people. Hers is the Magnificat of a pure and overflowing heart that sees all of history and each individual person with a mother's mercy. During the moments I was able to spend alone with Mary during my visit to Mexico, as I gazed at Our Lady, the Virgin of Guadalupe, and I let her gaze at me, I prayed for you, dear priests, to be good pastors of souls many times. In my address to the bishops, I mentioned that I have often reflected on the mystery of Mary's gaze its tenderness and its sweetness that gives us the courage to open our hearts to God's mercy. I would like now to reflect with you on a few of the ways that Our Lady gazes, especially at priests, since through us she wants to gaze at her people.
Maria ci guarda in modo tale che uno si sente accolto nel suo grembo.
Mary's gaze makes us feel her maternal embrace. She shows us that the only power capable of winning human hearts is the tenderness of God. What delights and attracts, humbles and overcomes, opens and unleashes, is not the power of instruments or the force of the law, but rather the omnipotent weakness of divine love, omnipotent weakness, which is the irresistible force of its gentleness and the irrevocable pledge of its mercy. What people seek in the eyes of Mary is a place of rest where people, still orphans and disinherited, may find a place of refuge, a home. And that has to do with the way she gazes. Her eyes open up a space that is inviting, not at all like a tribunal or an office.
Notate che si è indurito il vostro sguardo.
If at times people realize that their own gaze has become hardened, maybe through work or being exhausted.
Che si è indurito il vostro sguardo, che quando avvicinate la gente provate fastidio.
They tend to look at people with annoyance or coldness.
E guardate di nuovo a lei.
If you get that way, stop and look to her. Look at her with the eyes of the little ones, those that are the smallest among you. For Our Lady can remove every cataract that prevents them from seeing Christ in people's souls. She can remove the myopia that fails to see the needs of others, which are the needs of the incarnate Lord. As well as the hyperopia that cannot see the details, the small print, where the truly important things are played out in the life of the church and in the family. The gaze of Mary heals. Another aspect of Mary's gaze has to do with weaving, with cloth. Mary gazes by weaving, by finding a way to bring good out of all the things that people lay at her feet. I told the Mexican bishops that in the mantle of the Mexican soul, with the thread of its mestizo features, God has woven in La Morenita, the Virgin of Guadalupe, the face by which he wishes to be known. A spiritual master teaches us that whatever is said of Mary is said of the Church universally and of each soul individually. If we consider how God wove the face and figure of Our Lady of Guadalupe into Juan Diego's cloak, we can powerfully ponder how he was weaving our soul and the life of the whole Church. They say that it is impossible to see how the image of Our Lady was, quote-unquote, painted. It seems to have been somehow imprinted. I like to think that the miracle was not only that the image was imprinted or painted, but that the entire cloak was recreated, transformed from top to bottom. Each thread, those threads of the maguey leaf that women had learned from childhood to weave for their finest garments, was transfigured in its place and interwoven with all the others, revealed the face of Our Lady, her presence, and her surroundings. God's mercy does the same thing. It doesn't paint us a pretty face or airbrush the reality of who we are. Rather, the very threads of our poverty and sinfulness interwoven with the Father's love, it so weaves us that our soul is renewed and recovers its true image, the image of Jesus. It doesn't Photoshop us. With our misery and our sinfulness, when we take this and weave it together with the Father's love, our soul is renewed and recovers that image in which we were made, that of Jesus. So be priests capable of imitating this freedom of God, who chooses the humble in order to reveal the majesty of his countenance. Priests capable of imitating God's patience by weaving the new humanity, which your country awaits with the fine thread of all those whom you encounter. Don't give in to the temptation to go elsewhere. Don't ask the bishop for a transfer. No. Don't give in to the temptation to go elsewhere, as if the love of God were not powerful enough to bring about change. A third way of looking at Our Lady's gaze is that of attentive care. Mary's gaze is one of complete attention. She leaves everything else behind and is concerned only with the person in front of her. Like a mother, she is all eyes for the child who has something to tell her, all eyes and ears. Mothers, when they speak to their little ones, become small and imitate the way little children speak so that they'll learn how to speak. As the wonderful Guadalupe tradition teaches us, La Morenita, Our Lady, treasures the gaze of all those who look to her. She reflects the faces of all who come to her. There is something unique in the face of each person who comes to us looking for God. Not everyone looks to us in the same way. We need to realize this, to open our hearts and show concern for them. A priest who becomes impervious to the gazes of people is closed within himself. Only a church capable of attentive concern for all those who knock on her door can speak to them about God. If you're not able to do that, if you're not able to care for those people who knock at the door, you'll not be able to talk to them about God.
se non decifriamo le loro sofferenze,
unless we can see into people's suffering and recognize their needs,
nulla potremo offrire loro.
We'll have nothing to offer them.
La ricchezza che abbiamo scorre unicamente quando incontriamo la pochezza.
The riches we possess only flow forth when we truly encounter the needs of others. And this encounter takes place in our hearts as pastors.
Ai vostri vescovi dissi che prestino attenzione a voi, loro sacerdoti.
I asked your bishops to be attentive to you, their priests, and not to leave you exposed to loneliness and abandonment, easy prey to a worldliness that devours the heart. The world is watching us closely in order to devour us, to make us consumers. All of us need attention. A gaze of genuine concern. Be careful, I said to the bishops, and learn to read the faces of your priests in order to rejoice with them when they feel the joy of telling you all that they have done and taught, as we read in St. Mark's Gospel, chapter 6. Also, don't step back when they are humbled and can only weep because they have denied the Lord, as we read in Luke chapter 22, verse 61. Offer your support and communion with Christ whenever one of them, discouraged, goes out with Judas into the night, as we read in John 13. In these situations, your fatherly care for your priests must never be found wanting. Encourage communion among them. Seek to bring out the best in them and enlist them in great ventures, for the heart of an apostle was not made for small things.
Infine,
lastly,
come guarda Maria, Maria guarda in modo integro.
When we think about Mary's gaze, her gaze is integral, all-embracing. It brings everything together, our past, present, and future.
Non ha uno sguardo frammentato.
It's not fragmented
la misericordia fa vedere
or partial.
La
mercy can see things as a whole
ciò che è più necessario
and grasp what is most necessary. Like Mary at Cana, she empathetically foresaw what the lack of wine in the wedding feast would mean, and she asked Jesus to resolve the problem without anyone noticing. We can see our entire priestly life as somehow foreseen by Mary's mercy. She sees beforehand all things we lack and provides for them. Everything we need. If there is any good wine present in our lives, it is not due to our own merits, but to her anticipated mercy. What she sings about in the Magnificat, of how the Lord has looked with favor on her littleness, her lowliness, and remembered his covenant of mercy, and mercy shown from generation to the poor and the downtrodden. For Mary, history is mercy. We can conclude by praying the Salve Regina. The words of this prayer are vibrant with the mystery of the Magnificat. Mary is the Mother of Mercy, our life, our sweetness, and our hope. When you priests have dark, difficult moments, when you don't know what, you don't know what to do in the depths of your heart. I don't say only look to the mother, that you should do. I don't say only that. Go there and let yourselves be gazed upon by her in silence. Even if you were to fall asleep in that moment while she's gazing at you, this will help you in those difficult moments with the many mistakes maybe that you have made and had brought you to that place. Maybe that gaze will bring all of that filth in our lives, will make that into a vessel of mercy.
Lasciatevi guardare dalla Madonna.
Let yourselves be gazed upon by Mary.
Sono quelli che consideriamo il miglior recipiente della misericordia.
Her eyes of mercy are surely the greatest vessel of mercy, for their gaze enables us to drink in that kindness and goodness for which we hunger with a yearning that a look of love alone can satisfy.
Quegli occhi misericordiosi sono anche quelli che ci fanno vedere le opere di misericordia.
Her eyes of mercy also enable us to see God's mercy at work in human history and to find Jesus in the faces of our brothers and sisters. In Mary, we catch a glimpse of the promised land, the kingdom of mercy established by our Lord, which is already present in this life beyond the exile into which sin leads us. Taken by the hand by Mary, holding our hand as she does, and as we hold on to her mantle, as we grab onto her mantle, in my office, I have a beautiful image. Father Rupnik gave it to me. Of the Syncatabasis, where we see Mary is bringing Jesus to us. What I like most about it has, in one hand, the fullness of the law, and with his other hand, he's holding on to his mom's cloak. He too holds on to his mother's cloak. In the Russian tradition, the monks, the old Russian monks tell us that in these spiritual turbulences, troubles, we need to have take refuge under the Madonna's mantle. The first antiphon of the East, Subtum Presidium. Under the mantle of Our Lady, Subtum Presidium, to be under her mantle. Be there. Let yourself be covered and helped, and let yourself cry even. When we find a priest who is able to do this, to go to the Madonna and to cry, even with numerous sins, I can say he's a good priest because he's a good son, and so he will be a good father. Taken by her hand,
La mia anima ti canta, Signore, perché
we can joyfully proclaim the greatness of the Lord. To Mary we can say, my soul sings of you, Lord, for you have looked with favor on the lowliness and humility of your servant. How blessed I am to have been forgiven. Your mercy, Lord, that you showed to your saints and to all your faithful people, you have also shown to me. I was lost, seeking only myself and the arrogance of my heart. Yet I found no glory. My only glory is that your mother has embraced me, covered me with her mantle, and drawn me to her heart. I want to be loved as one of your little ones. I want to feed with your bread all those who hunger for you. Remember, Lord, of your covenant of mercy with your sons, the priests of your people. With Mary, may we be the sign and sacrament of your mercy. With those words, Pope Francis concluding this, his second meditation today. We'll continue with a closing prayer and hymn. Two beautiful reflections so far by Pope Francis on this day dedicated to a retreat for priests. The hymn to Mary, Queen of Heaven, here in her Basilica in Rome, the Basilica of Our Lady of St. Mary Major, which houses the famous icon Salus Populi Romani, which the Holy Father visits before and after each one of his trips. We see him making his way down the central nave here in the Basilica, greeting the priests who have come to Rome for this event. It's 1 p.m. here in Rome, and we're halfway through this day, which is dedicated for retreat for priests who have come to Rome for their Jubilee. We heard a meditation this morning. We began in the Basilica here of St. John Lateran, the mother of all Catholic churches throughout the world. We're here now at St. Mary Major, where Pope Francis gave his second meditation today on being vessels of God's mercy. Now all the retreat participants will have a break for lunch. At 4 p.m. is the next appointment here in Rome, 4 p.m. at the Basilica of St. Paul's outside the walls. And St. Peter's, of course, not to be left out, a mass will be celebrated at St. Peter's tomorrow on the Feast of the Sacred Heart, the Feast of the Priesthood Worldwide, and that's tomorrow at 9:30 a.m. local time here in Rome. We're going to leave you with these beautiful images which are housed here in the Basilica of St. Mary Major. Beautiful image there of the Holy Family with the baby Jesus. Part of the crib from Bethlehem is even kept here as a relic. And we invite you to tune back in at 4 p.m. Rome time from wherever you're following this ceremony today. We thank you so much for joining us. And as the Holy Father has asked us to continue to pray for priests during the month of June, this month of the Sacred Heart, this month of the celebration of the priesthood. We'll leave you with the images here live from St. Mary Major. On behalf of all of us here at Vatican Radio and Vatican Television, thank you for joining us. Laudetur Jesus Christus.